On the morning of Sunday, September the 17th, 1944, the inhabitants of southern England were witness to one of the most amazing sights ever seen in the history of warfare. In the skies above the English countryside, a vast air armada formed into position. From 22 different airfields, Allied planes took to the air. It was a spectacular beginning to a remarkable military operation. That morning, over 1,000 transport planes could be seen from the ground. 500 gliders joined them, attached to their tow planes. Hundreds of British and American fighters also flew in support. It was an awesome display of air power. In a matter of minutes, two mighty fleets were formed over the English towns of Hatfield and March. On board the Allied aircraft was a newly created fighting machine. This was the first Allied airborne army en route to battle. Its destination, predetermined drop zones across the English Channel. The Allied airborne troops knew that they would be landing in Holland, and they were soon on their way. It was a sight that is still remembered today. When the two air fleets began their journey away from England, they each formed a column of aircraft over 90 miles long and 3 miles wide. This was dramatic visual evidence that the biggest airborne operation ever had begun. It was the start of a major strategic offensive of enormous ambition. The prize on offer was as compelling as the sight of the Allied warplanes as they crossed the Channel into Northwest Europe. The men of the 1st Airborne Army knew the task that lay ahead as they prepared to make their jumps over the flat landscape of Holland. Their objective was to secure key strategic locations along a 60-mile corridor through occupied Dutch territory. If successful, the airborne troops would clear the way for a simultaneous Allied advance by troops already in position on the ground in Belgium. This was the beginning of Operation Market Garden, one of the most ambitious enterprises of the Second World War. The Allies hoped that a combined air and ground offensive through Holland would enable them to bypass the Siegfried Line. Also known as the West Wall, this was the line of fortifications that protected the heartland of Germany itself. If the operation succeeded, Allied forces could sweep into Germany from positions to the north of the Siegfried Line. It was a chance to bring the war to an end before the end of 1944. But it would not be an easy task. As the Allied paratroops and airlanders prepared to make their drop into Dutch territory, their commanders knew that a hard fight lay ahead if this bold objective was to be achieved. As events transpired, it was the men of the 1st British Parachute Division who faced the hardest fight of all. Their strategic objective was situated in the most northerly sector of the Allied advance. Its location has come to be associated with the remarkable story of the Market Garden operation as a whole. As the British paratroops leapt from their planes, they knew that their task was to capture and hold a single bridge in a medium-sized Dutch city. This was the bridge at Arnhem. On the morning of September the 17th, 1944, the British Field Marshal Bernard Montgomery waited for dramatic events to unfold as his Operation Market Garden began in Holland. Without question, it was Montgomery's plan, a bold initiative by a brilliant commander with a reputation for caution on the battlefield. By September 1944, Montgomery's talents had secured him the position of commander of 21st Army Group, one of the three vast forces under the overall command of the American General Dwight Eisenhower. But it was Montgomery's Army Group who were given the chance to execute a radical operation that could bring a speedy end to the war. If successful, it would put the final seal on the career of Field Marshal Bernard Montgomery. Montgomery's plan for a huge combined offensive involving ground and airborne troops did offer the real chance of ending the war by the end of 1944. But Operation Market Garden was an endeavor with a number of risks, and Montgomery knew it. Speed and surprise would be essential for the operation to succeed, but no one could be sure how events would unfold on the ground. The Allied commanders could not be certain of the strength of the German presence in occupied Holland. They didn't know for sure how much anti-aircraft fire would be deployed against the planes making the journey from England. And this uncertainty had serious consequences. Fear of flak meant that the British paratroops dropped over Arnhem were forced to use a landing site some 8 miles west of the city, a situation that seriously compromised the potential for speed and surprise. The British effort was also hampered by a shortage of transport aircraft that meant spreading the Arnhem landings over 3 days, with an independent Polish brigade scheduled to arrive last. The Polish General Sosabowski was just one commander who openly recognized the potential for bad weather to stretch the timetable still further. Many senior American commanders also questioned the sheer scale of Montgomery's offensive. But on the 17th of September 1944, there was no more time for arguments and no turning back. That morning, in the most dramatic manner possible, Operation Market Garden was launched. Late in the evening of Saturday the 16th of September, Allied bomber squadrons began taking off from airfields across England. Their mission was to attack German ground positions in Holland and prepare the way for the vast air armada to come. At 09:30 hours the following morning, in good weather conditions, the Allied transport planes and towed gliders also began to take to the air. Shortly after midday, the leading planes of two vast columns of aircraft began to appear in the skies over Holland. From the ground, Dutch citizens looked on in amazement as British and American paratroops and airlanders descended into occupied territory. For the local population, this was a sight they had prayed for. The skies filled with paratroops filled their hearts with joy. After 4 years, surely this was the liberation of their homeland. From any point of view, it was an amazing spectacle. It was the biggest airborne landing of the war. Nearly three full divisions made it safely to the ground at designated zones along the main road from the Belgian border to the city of Arnhem. But there was no time to waste. As soon as they had landed, the airborne forces were quickly into action in pursuit of their objectives. Around the city of Eindhoven, the men of the 101st American Airborne Division were tasked with the capture of two major canal bridges, including the crossing of the Wilhelmina Canal at Sens. Further north, the American 82nd Airborne set about the business of seizing two great river crossings, one of them the mighty road bridge at Nijmagen. These were key objectives of Operation Market, the codename given to the airborne component of Montgomery's offensive. At 1400 hours, Monty's ground forces also made their move, with a huge artillery barrage launched from positions at a river crossing known as Joe's Bridge, close to the Belgian border. Shortly afterwards, Cromwell tanks of the Guards Armoured Division led the way for the advance north of General Horrocks's British 30th Corps, as flanking advances began through the countryside. Operation Market was now joined with Operation Garden, and the combined Market Garden offensive had begun. To the north, the men of the 1st British Airborne Corps were also keen to get into the action after making their landings 8 miles to the west of Arnhem. It was already apparent that the German flak had not been as severe as anticipated, and a drop zone nearer to the British objective of Arnhem Bridge might have been possible after all. As the Skytrain transport planes began their journey back to England, it was clear that the whole market deployment had suffered little in the way of losses. But a number of gliders did crash, and in one case, this had catastrophic consequences for the Allied cause. But in the late afternoon of the 17th of September, the biggest problem faced by the men of 1st British Parachute Division seemed to be the huge number of Dutch citizens greeting them with gifts and celebrations. At long last, the Dutch were being liberated. Or so they thought. But the scenes of joy only served to slow the British as the three battalions of the 1st Parachute Brigade set off towards Arnhem Bridge. And the paratroopers would soon face a more serious obstacle to progress. Unknown to Brigade Commander General Lathbury or Divisional Commander Roy Urquhart, the German response to Operation Market Garden was already in place. In the summer of 1944, the Allied triumph in Normandy and the breakout into France that followed proved to be a disastrous turn of events for Germany. No fewer than 40 out of the 50 Wehrmacht divisions deployed in the Western theatre were lost. By the 4th of September, the retreating German forces were still in disarray as the aging Field Marshal Geert von Rundstedt returned to regional command to try and reorganize Hitler's decimated armies. But all was not yet lost. The German High Command succeeded in putting together new divisions formed from ex-sailors, airmen, units of Hitler Youth, and anyone else remotely fit for combat. It was a reinforcement operation that became known as the Miracle of the West. By the time the Allies launched Operation Market Garden, some sort of structure had been restored to the German command in the Western Theatre, and von Rundstedt knew that he still had a number of fanatical SS units at his disposal. He was also well aware that a number of excellent commanders had survived the slaughter in France and were now in Holland. Of these, none had more influence on the final outcome of the Battle of Arnhem than the commander of German Army Group B. At lunchtime on the 17th of September 1944, Field Marshal Walter Mörtel was enjoying a meal of salmon at his headquarters at the Hartenstein Hotel, located in the Dutch town of Oosterbeek, just to the west of Arnhem. Around 1300 hours, his leisure was interrupted by the dramatic news of the Allied landings, including British landings just 2 miles away to the west. The German commander's response was immediate. Mörtel was already a famous soldier. In the course of the Second World War, he acquired the nickname the Führer's Fireman because of his ability to take charge of a difficult battle situation and turn it round. On the 17th of September 1944, Field Marshal Mörtel proved that his command skills remained intact. As soon as news of the landings reached him at the Hartenstein Hotel, Mörtel abandoned his meal and left Oosterbeek to re-establish his HQ further east. The question was how best to respond to the Allied landings. The army commander knew he had a number of battalions already in the Arnhem region, including the SS Depot Battalion of Major Sepp Kraft. These were mobilized at once to engage the British advance towards Arnhem Bridge. Mörtel's command also included the 1st Parachute Army, based further south at the town of Voort. Army Commander Kurt Student was another highly regarded officer, and he was given the task of dealing with Allied activity in the Eindhoven region. All over Holland, German troops were prompted into action, as von Rundstedt signaled to Hitler that reinforcements would be needed. Stunned by the Allied assault, Hitler agreed to send new resources to Holland, and the defeat of Market Garden became the highest priority for the German war effort. But Walter Mörtel knew he already had a substantial force just waiting to be used on Dutch territory. On the afternoon of the 17th of September, Mörtel's first port of call was the headquarters of General Willy Beetrich to the northeast of Arnhem. Beetrich was commander of the 2nd SS Panzer Corps, an armoured force whose presence in the region had been indicated to the Allies by a Dutch intelligence report. Unfortunately for the Allied cause, the report was ignored, and the two Panzer divisions under Beatrix's command were quickly on the move on the afternoon of the 17th of September. The 10th Division was dispatched towards Nijmegen. The 9th Division moved to support the local forces already preparing to engage the British in Arnhem. The vigorous German response to news of the landings was impressive by any standards. Day one of Operation Market Garden gave the first clear hints that the Allies would not have things all their own way, as battle was joined in Holland. To the south, German forces succeeded in blowing up the canal bridge at Sens. This meant that the American 101st Division could not advance north of the canal until 30th Corps arrived with bridging equipment from the south. But although 30th Corps made a good start to their advance, the leading armoured units were ordered to a halt on the evening of the 17th, having advanced only as far as Valkensvaard, some 10 miles from Sens. Further north, two more small bridges were blown, preventing the American 82nd Airborne from reaching its main objective of the Nijmegen Road Bridge, a half-mile structure that Mödl ordered left intact in case of a German counterattack. Well before midnight on day one, it was clear that German forces were still keen to take up the fight. But their efforts were aided by a priceless stroke of good fortune. On the afternoon of the 17th, one of the Allied gliders that crashed during the Great Airborne Landing was inspected by an officer of Students' 1st Parachute Army. What he found was astonishing. On board were the complete plans for Operation Market Garden. The German commanders could hardly believe their luck. The Allies no longer possessed the element of surprise. The British would pay an especially heavy price in the days that followed at Arnhem. The German capture of the Market Garden plan was an enormous setback for an offensive based largely on surprise. But Allied hopes of success were already compromised by the details of the plan itself. The decision to land the British some 8 miles from their objective was based on exaggerated estimates of German flak defences, and the British paratroops soon found that their march to Arnhem Bridge was compromised still further. Before long, it became depressingly clear that there were serious problems with the radio equipment issued to the British airborne units. Either the sets failed to work at all, or their reception and range were feeble. But this might not have been a serious problem had the British landed in greater numbers on day one. As it was, just 3 battalions of the 1st Parachute Brigade were dispatched east towards Arnhem Bridge on the afternoon of the 17th, leaving 1st Air Landing Brigade to secure the landing sites. First Battalion, the Parachute Regiment, took a path to the north of the town of Oosterbeek. 3rd Battalion set off through the town along a line which passed the Hartenstein Hotel, former headquarters of the German Walter Mödl, and soon to become the divisional HQ for the British Roy Urquhart. Furthest south of all, the men of 2nd Battalion took a route closer to the north bank of the Lower Rhine. In a matter of minutes, the British knew they had a fight on their hands. By early evening, the main problem facing the British was not cheering Dutch civilians, but a keen and well-armed enemy. First and 3rd Battalions were met with stiff resistance from Sepp Kraft's SS Depot Battalion on the outskirts of Oosterbeek. Close-quarter street fighting with rifle, mortar and machine gun descended on the town as the local population sought to take cover. Despite valiant efforts, neither of the 2 battalions were able to make it through to Arnhem Bridge. battle was now joined in earnest. A British machine gunner of the 3rd Battalion achieved a notable success when the local German commandant was killed in his staff car earlier in the evening. But by the end of the day, it was the Germans who could be most pleased with events at Arnhem. Only the men of 3rd Battalion succeeded in breaking through to Arnhem Bridge along the lightly defended riverside roadway. Battalion Commander Lieutenant Colonel John Frost was one of the most experienced paratroopers in the British Army, but he could not prevent local German units destroying a pontoon bridge and railway bridge over the Lower Rhine. But by 2000 hours on day one, Frost's men had reached the northern end of Arnhem Road Bridge, where they set about establishing their position in the locality. There was still fighting to be done. Troops of the 10th Panzer Division attempted to break through to the bridge from the north before being held back in a fierce exchange where Frost's men were glad of the anti-tank guns that landed with them earlier in the day. By midnight, 2nd Battalion held a secure position to the north of Arnhem Bridge. But any hope of capturing the bridge was thwarted by an SS battalion positioned by General Bittrich to the south. A dramatic day ended with John Frost's men waiting for reinforcements to arrive on day two of Operation Market Garden. Relief could come from his fellow paratroopers to the west or the advancing ground troops moving up from the south. Colonel Frost dared not consider what the consequences would be if neither arrived. Shortly after the launch of Operation Market Garden, Field Marshal Montgomery suggested to the British General Staff that the ground troops of 30th Corps would be in Arnhem by the end of day two. In fact, General Brian Horrocks' men advanced no further than the town of Sens, where work on a Bailey Bridge began that evening, still 40 miles south of Tupara's position at Arnhem Bridge. It was already clear that progress was slow along the road known as the Club Route. In total, 30th Corps had to move some 23,000 vehicles north along one double-track road, and the sheer amount of traffic hindered the advance to Arnhem. On either side of the Club Route, the flanking advances of 8th and 12th Corps made even less progress in the flat, marshy polderland. By the end of the day, many Allied commanders were gravely concerned at the rate of the ground advance, with some American officers openly irritated that the efforts of their airborne troops were not being exploited fully by the British. From the moment of the first landings, American airborne troops were quickly into action. Day two of Operation Market Garden saw two battalions of the American 508th Parachute Infantry Regiment make a series of brave attempts to capture the vital road bridge at Nijmegen. All of them were repulsed in fierce exchanges, as American Divisional Commander James Gavin began to wonder if the British would ever arrive to support him. The only consolation for Gavin was the limited German reinforcement in the region to the north of the Nijmegen Bridge. With the British paratroopers still holding the northern end of Arnhem Bridge, new German troops were forced to make a canal crossing to the east of Arnhem to join their colleagues in the fight with the Americans. Frost's situation at the bridge was helped by the fact that his radios were in working order, and he was able to call on the support of British howitzer crews, which prevented his position from being overrun. But what Frost's 500 or so men needed was a breakthrough to their position, and despite the bravest efforts of the 1st Parachute Brigade, the 2nd Battalion was left isolated at the bridge all through September the 18th. It was a day of devastating street fighting, as the city of Arnhem and the town of Oosterbeek shook with the full force of war. Once again, the mortar and the machine gun were generously deployed by both sides, but the increasingly powerful German forces had one priceless advantage. Unlike the British paratroopers, they could employ the big guns of the artillery and the tank. All through the 18th of September, British positions were assaulted by shellfire from the 75mm long-barreled guns of the Type 4 Panzer. German commanders also knew that reinforcements of mighty Type 6 Tigers were also on their way to the battle zone. By contrast, the nearest Cromwells and Shermans of the British 30th Corps were still over 40 miles away. As the day went on, Arnhem and Oosterbeek became visions of destruction as bullets and shells whistled through the air. Soldiers on both sides could not be sure where enemy fire was coming from or whether it was enemy fire at all. But the British paratroops had no choice but to engage as best they could. If they failed to break through to Frost at Arnhem Bridge, the whole Market Garden operation stood to fail. But as the day went on, all that 1st and 3rd Battalion could report was desperate casualty figures. No British unit was able to get within a mile of their colleagues at Arnhem Bridge. A sense of trepidation began to emerge in the minds of British commanders. The operation was going badly wrong on the battlefield of Arnhem and Oosterbeek. The British corps suffered a serious blow when Divisional Commander Urquhart and Brigade Commander Lathbury found themselves trapped in the attic of a house with a German tank stationed outside the front door. All day long, the two men were forced to stay in hiding, unable to communicate with their colleagues. To make matters worse, Brigadier Lathbury had been seriously injured by a sniper's bullet. Back at the landing sites, command passed to Brigadier Pip Hicks of the 1st Air Landing Brigade, a force of three battalions who'd landed with 1st Parachute Brigade on day one. Recognizing the seriousness of the situation, Hicks dispatched as many of his men as he dared in the direction of Arnhem. But confusion was now the real order of the day, as the dangers of the staggered deployment of British forces revealed themselves. Hicks knew that the 4th British Parachute Brigade were due to take off from England at 0600 hours on day two. But fog delayed the transport by a precious 4 hours. And when the aircraft carrying the new brigade eventually arrived over Holland, the Germans knew they were coming. 20 Allied fighters were shot down defending the unarmored SkyTrain transports. And 4th Brigade Commander John Hackett soon recognized the seriousness of the situation on the ground. Despite this, Hackett's men moved immediately in support of their fellow paratroopers already suffering in Oosterbeek. Few British soldiers were able to advance as far as Arnhem itself, where 2nd Battalion still held on despite the pounding of their positions by German shellfire. In the cellars of the local houses and buildings, the casualties and the dead could be found alongside each other as ammunition and supplies began to run out. By the end of day two, the situation facing 2 Para was serious. By the end of day three, it was almost hopeless. By the early morning of the 19th of September 1944, the city of Arnhem and the town of Oosterbeek had both been battlegrounds for 36 hours, as fighting continued amongst the rubble of ruined buildings. That morning, what was left of 1 Para and 3 Para made a final desperate attempt to reach their colleagues at the bridge, making a move along the Lower Rhine, using the morning fog as cover. When it lifted, they were exposed to massive German fire from both north and south. In a terrible battle, the two British battalions were all but wiped out. To the north, Hackett's 4th Brigade also suffered heavy casualties in fierce exchanges around the railway line, as all the time the men of 2 Para remained isolated on the north bank of Arnhem Bridge. Back in England, more bad weather confirmed the folly of splitting the deployment of the British Airborne Corps. The 19th of September was scheduled as the day when the independent Polish brigade of General Sosabowski would finally be transported to the Arnhem region. But all day long the rain came down over England, grounding the furious Sosabowski and his men. but the Polish complement of 35 gliders was able to be towed into the air, to be taken to a planned landing site to the northwest of Oosterbeek. It was assumed that this region would be securely in Allied hands by day three. But the strength of the German resistance meant that when the Polish gliders began to come down, they descended into the middle of a battleground, and the consequences were severe. Virtually all the men and material were lost. Poor communications meant that the Poles had no idea of the fate that awaited them. Radio difficulties also caused problems with resupply flights. On many occasions, the Allies sent vital food and weapons parachuting to the ground behind the German lines, much to the delight of the defenders. The battle for Arnhem was turning into a nightmare, and Operation Market Garden was in deep trouble. There was some good news for the Allies on the 19th of September. Roy Urquhart was able to escape from his attic hiding place and return to his divisional headquarters at the Hartenstein Hotel, to the pleasant surprise of his fellow officers. Further south, the ground advance of 30th Corps also made substantive progress. In the early hours of the day, the first armoured British units began to cross the completed Bailey Bridge at Sens, heading north in the direction of their beleaguered colleagues. By the end of the day, the leading British tank crews had covered some 36 miles and linked up with the American 82nd Airborne to the south of Nijmegen. At once, Generals Horrocks and Gavin set about a combined assault against the Nijmegen Road Bridge. But still, the German defences held, as all the time the men of 2nd Battalion despaired of relief just 10 miles to the north. By the end of day three, the men of Tupara were exhausted, and their numbers were dwindling. Somehow, their commander was able to maintain order and morale as the closest attentions of the enemy continued. The British paratroopers still hoped to be relieved, but by now, even John Frost began to wonder if assistance would ever arrive. By the early evening of September the 20th, day four of the Market Garden offensive, there was still hope that the ambitious objectives of the Allied offensive could be achieved. Perhaps the war still could be ended in 1944. But time was now of the essence. At Arnhem Bridge, Frost's battalion of 500 had been reduced to around 150, with the wounded and dead piling up in the cellars. Amazingly, the decimated force of paratroopers continued to hold on to their position. The precious support of 75mm howitzer fire enabled Tupara to hold off a number of German infantry attacks on September the 20th. But there was little that the British troops could do against heavy German artillery fire. They also had to endure repeated attacks on their position by the 88mm guns of the fearsome Tiger tanks, now established at the battle zone. Frost's men were running low on ammunition, food, and especially water, as their positions were gradually pounded into rubble. But still, the British paratroopers held out. John Frost had dismissed one corps for surrender with contempt, and Tupara's resistance continued even after their commander himself was badly injured. But on the evening of September the 20th, after 3 days of epic command, John Frost's battle finally came to an end. Having handed over command to Major Freddie Gough, Frost became one of 200 wounded British prisoners who gave themselves up as part of a truce arranged by Gough. It was a low-key end to a brave show of resistance. But by now there was nothing that Tupara could do without support breaking through to them. As the hours passed and the German attacks continued, time was beginning to run out for the British paratroops. To the west, Roy Urquhart began to draw what remained of his 1st Parachute Division into a horseshoe-shaped pocket at Oosterbeek. The British commander recognized that there was nothing his men could do for their colleagues at the bridge. The German positions were just too strong. Back in England, bad weather again caused the postponement of the transports due to bring General Sosabowski's Poles to the Arnhem battlefield. The Polish general was now furious. Sosabowski's anger reflected his sheer frustration at being unable to influence the outcome of the battle. All his concerns about a staggered airborne deployment were now being borne out. Only the ground troops of 30th Corps could do anything for Tupara now. By the early afternoon of day 4 of Operation Market Garden, the advance armoured units of British 30th Corps were finally in a position to support their American colleagues of 82nd Division. Now the Anglo-American commanders could make a concerted attack on Nijmegen Bridge, the last main barrier on the route to Arnhem. The commander of the British Airborne Corps had now arrived in the region, and General Browning and his senior colleagues conceived a bold plan to take the bridge at Nijmegen. It would be one of the most effective Anglo-American operations of the war. Assault boats had arrived at last, and men of the 504th American Parachute Infantry Regiment were tasked with using them to make a crossing of the fast-flowing River Waal to the west of the Nijmegen Railway Bridge. But the main objective remained the road bridge furthest east, and the American crossing was intended as part of a joint operation with the British to secure the structure from both north and south. At 1500 hours, the men of the American 504th Parachute Infantry took to the water in their small assault boats in the face of withering German machine gun and artillery fire from the north bank. Casualties were inevitable and substantial, but the Americans succeeded in landing 2 battalions on the north bank of the river. At once, they set off east towards the railway bridge. Here, another fierce engagement took place, but it was again the Americans who prevailed. By late afternoon, the Stars and Stripes flew at the northern end of the rail bridge, and as the Americans pressed west towards the huge road bridge, their colleagues in the 504th Parachute Infantry began an advance through Nijmegen. Alongside them, British armoured units of the Grenadier Guards. At 19:10 hours, the first tanks of the Grenadiers arrived at the southern end of the road bridge, driving straight onto the structure to link up with their American colleagues on the north bank. What happened next was a moment of drama that has rarely been surpassed in the history of warfare. Field Marshal Myrtle had given express orders that Nijmegen Bridge should not be destroyed, but his most senior officer on the ground had other ideas. As the battle began to turn against the German defenders at Nijmegen, Brigadier Hamel gave the order to fit explosive charges to the bridge structure. At the very moment that the first British tanks began to cross, Hamel ordered that the charges be detonated, but they failed to go off. The bridge remained intact, and the path to Arnhem was open for the British tanks. But the chance to relieve Tupara was not taken. Instead of pressing on to Arnhem at once, the guards halted overnight, claiming exhaustion and a lack of infantry support. Only at midday the following day did the Welsh and Irish guards move forward towards Arnhem. By then it was too late. At almost exactly the same time, the battle for Arnhem Bridge finally came to an end. That morning, the decisive German assault began against a ragged band of exhausted, thirsty men. But still, the fighting spirit of Tupara revealed itself. The British troops had to be cleared out house by house, room by room. It was a grim business, as the epic stand of the paratroopers gradually came to its end. The Germans still moved with caution, One favourite tactic was to use artillery and panzer fire against the British positions, followed up by infantry flamethrower attacks to force their enemy to surrender or die fighting. Many men of Tupara chose the latter option. In the end, the British were defeated at Arnhem Bridge, but the men of Tupara could have done nothing more in pursuit of their objective. Their bravery in the face of the enemy that surrounded them was remarkable. Their sheer endurance was equally impressive, and the Germans themselves were full of admiration for the fighting spirit of their adversary. More than any other battle, Arnhem Bridge established the continuing high reputation of the British Parachute Regiment. But despite this, Arnhem Bridge had proved to be a bridge too far. And as German panzers began to pour across the Lower Rhine, the whole nature of the Market Garden operation began to change. With Arnhem lost, the focus of the battle shifted west to Oosterbeek, where the remainder of the 1st Parachute Division were also facing a desperate situation. By the afternoon of the 21st of September, Operation Market Garden was into day five, and the Allied leadership began to recognize that Montgomery's great plan for an invasion of Germany was not going to succeed. As the fighting continued on the ground in Holland, Supreme Commander Eisenhower convened a meeting of his most senior commanders to a place near Paris the following day. A new strategy was urgently required. But in Oosterbeek, the suffering men of the 1st Parachute Division were more concerned with holding onto their pocket to the north of the Lower Rhine. But the 21st of September began badly for Urquhart's men. That morning, the British lost control of the important high ground at Westerboeing to a German assault. But still the British held on, hoping that relief would come from the south. But the final defeat of Tupara at Arnhem Bridge enabled German reinforcements to stream across the river throughout the day. Their task was to defend the final 10 miles between Nijmegen and Arnhem, and they succeeded in their objective. All day long, the British guards were unable to break through, although the heavy British artillery was at last able to direct its shellfire in support of their colleagues trapped in the Oosterbeek pocket. The pocket itself was now known as the Cauldron, as heavy German guns were brought to bear against the British positions. It wasn't the only term to reflect the progress of the battle. Further south, the clogged road to Arnhem acquired the nickname Hell's Highway, as German attacks continued from both sides. Many Allied officers began to squabble amongst themselves, with some Americans expressing a strong opinion that the British advance north was far too slow. The only good news for the Allied cause on the 21st of September was an improvement in the weather back in England. At last, the main elements of the Polish Parachute Brigade could take to the air to join the battle in Holland. At 1700 hours, Sosabowski's men finally landed at a predetermined position opposite the Oosterbeek pocket, south of the Lower Rhine, at Driel. Immediately, the Germans moved to reinforce the position between Driel and the southern end of the Arnhem Bridge. If the Poles were to join their colleagues trapped in the Oosterbeek pocket, they would have to cross the river themselves. But all the Allied assault boats were in the possession of 30th Corps, still struggling with a strong German presence to the south. There was nothing Sosabowski could do. By the end of day five, the British ground troops had still not joined up with any of their airborne colleagues. Only on day six did some advance parties of 30th Corps succeed in reaching the Poles on the south side of the Lower Rhine, but still the assault boats were nowhere to be seen. That evening, a frustrated General Sosabowski ordered a crossing of the river using four flimsy rubber craft. It was all he had at his disposal. It was a treacherous enterprise. The water was fast moving, and the Germans were able to train their fire from the Westerboeing high ground opposite. But the Poles were desperate to get into the action, and their fighting spirit could not be contained. That night, 15 Polish troops died in the waters of the Lower Rhine. But 35 courageous men did make it safely to their British colleagues on the north side. By now, the Allies had recognized that the grand ambitions of Operation Market Garden were not going to be fulfilled. The war in the West would not be over by Christmas. On the afternoon of September the 22nd, Eisenhower and his senior theater commanders agreed that the defeat of Germany would require more than an advance by the British. Instead, a new unified strategy involving the entire Allied presence in northwestern Europe was determined to advance towards the Reich. Amazingly, the meeting took place without the presence of the Field Marshal whose grand scheme had now proved to be a failure. Bernard Montgomery sent his Chief of Staff instead. When the most senior Allied commanders in Europe finally accepted that the battle for Arnhem was lost, the prime mover behind the battle was nowhere to be seen. Though Montgomery later talked of the operation having been 90% successful, he knew in his own mind that this represented failure. The only failure of a remarkable career. But there was one last task for the Allies to carry out. Around the same time as the Allied strategy conference in France, the commander of the trapped British paratroops at Oosterbeek signalled that he could not be expected to hold the pocket for much longer. By Sunday the 24th of September, the British perimeter was retreating as the heat of the cauldron continued to rise. The fate of the men at Arnhem Bridge now loomed for General Urquhart and his exhausted soldiers. He could now muster only 1,800 active men. A total of 1,200 lay injured and wounded as the streets were pounded to rubble by merciless German shellfire. Roy Urquhart later described his impression that his command wasn't much of a division as the battle approached its end. Instead, he described a collection of individuals holding on. It was an appropriate description, but there was still a chance for them to escape and fight another day. On the evening of Saturday the 23rd of September, a second crossing of the Lower Rhine was made by men of the British Dorset Regiment, who'd finally broken through the German defences between Arnhem and Nijmegen. But in spite of the fact that 30th Corps had at last achieved its objective and secured the Allied corridor from the Belgian border to Arnhem, Operation Market Garden was effectively over. The crossing of the Dorsets was made to secure Urquhart's position in preparation for a withdrawal of the whole division back across the river. Despite a week of courageous fighting on the streets of Oosterbeek, the Germans had won what is still known as the Battle of Arnhem. It was time for the British to leave the battlefield. On the evening of Monday the 25th of September, the escape from Arnhem, codenamed Operation Berlin, began. Under cover of an artillery barrage, four companies of engineers, two British and two Canadian, put the evacuation plan into action. After the failure of Operation Market Garden, the withdrawal operation proved to be a far more successful enterprise. In darkness and driving rain, 35 boats shuttled back and forth across the Lower Rhine, bringing the remaining men of the 1st Parachute Division to safety, all the time harassed by machine gun and mortar fire. The urgency of the withdrawal meant that the badly wounded had to be left behind as the panzers began to move into the pocket towards the line of the river. But the withdrawal did catch the German defenders by surprise, and enemy attention was lighter than might have been feared. In all, 2,163 men were rescued, among them the exhausted General Urquhart. Days later, they returned to Britain to a hero's welcome, but many of their old colleagues never saw their homeland again. 2,163 men may have been rescued during Operation Berlin, but this was out of a total of 10,000 men deployed. Around 1,200 British and Polish troops had lost their lives. To the south, American total losses approached 4,000 dead, wounded, or captured, and the objective of Operation Market Garden had not been achieved. The city of Arnhem remained in German hands, and the war would continue well into 1945. For the Allied generals, especially the Americans, who had doubted Montgomery's plan all the time, its failure was a grim vindication of their skepticism. Of all the significant operations of World War II, Operation Market Garden remains one of the most widely discussed today. But the overall failure is not disputed. The Allied defeat stemmed from a number of factors. The skills, weaponry, and leadership displayed by the enemy was crucial, and the German cause was given a priceless boost by the discovery of the Allied plans. But the Allied troops also acquitted themselves well. The courage of Erkut's men at Arnhem and Oosterbeek is still recalled with pride in Britain and elsewhere. The contribution of the American and Polish troops was also impressive. But it's difficult to avoid the conclusion that the men who fought so bravely here were let down badly by serious mistakes made by their own commanders. With hindsight, we can see the plan itself was flawed. The decision to stagger the airborne deployment proved to be as disastrous as General Sosabowski had feared. The choice of British landing zones 8 miles from Arnhem was another decision with serious consequences for the Allied cause. The strength of German flak was overestimated. The strength of German forces on the ground was underestimated. When battle was joined, poor communications hampered the efforts of the British airborne troops, and the 1st Parachute Corps was let down badly by the slow advance of their countrymen along Hell's Highway. But in the end, Market Garden may not have succeeded in any circumstances. It was a remarkable operation, but events in Arnhem proved that this was a bridge too far.